Good morning. There is no less than or greater than when it comes to judging courageous endeavors. Resist the urge to form a ledger where you rank the deeds of the bravery of others above your own forays into the scary unknown. My name is Sherry Cook. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I've been a member of this amazing congregation for about 13 years, and I'm honored to share this Sunday morning with you. On March 17th of 2019, I stepped onto the Appalachian Trail at its southern terminus on Springer Mountain in Amicalola Falls, Georgia. 206 days and 2,192 miles later, I climbed the summit of Mount Katahdin, a 5,269-foot peak located in Baxter State Park in Maine, the Holy Grail of northbound, known as NOBO, AT Thru-Hikers. Before, during, and since that journey, I've spent a great deal of time reflecting on the nature of courage. Today, I thank you for allowing me the opportunity to share some of those musings with you.
Good morning, and welcome. I'm Rob Craig Coleman, a member of the Worship Arts team, and the summer services coordinator this year. My pronouns are he, him, and his. Welcome to our worship service. Welcome to our church home, and welcome to our online church community. We welcome you whether you're old or young, straight or gay, cisgender, queer gender, or just choose to make up your own gender. We welcome you for whatever makes you unique, makes you proud, makes you feel special. If you're with us for the first time, then you've been to our website, uureading.org. Just underneath the description of today's service, you'll find the link that says, click for more information about our virtual worship options during COVID-19. There you will find information about how to sign up for our new member coffee hour, which is happening periodically throughout the summer, although it isn't happening today. Also on the website, you'll find contact information for Melissa Martin, our member services coordinator, who will help guide you through getting connected with UUCR. Today, after the service, as we do each week, we have a time for gathering and sharing and connecting a bit more directly through small group Zoom conversation. The link for Zoom coffee hour can be found in the weekly UUCR email. And even if you don't go to Zoom coffee hour, still check the weekly email for what is happening at UUCR this week and in upcoming weeks. Finally, I want to tell you something. You belong here. And you are welcome here. Maybe just for the next hour, but we hope for longer. You are welcome here, and we are glad you're here. We are all glad we're all here this morning. Welcome.
Please join us in our chalice lighting words, which can be found in the order of service. In the light of truth, the warmth of community, the fire of commitment, we gather this day. May the flame we now kindle be to us a symbol of the holiness we seek.
Thank you.
Everybody. Today I want to read to you one of my favorite stories. It's called Tomorrow I'll Be Brave by Jessica Hish. So I was thinking, you know, we can't be in church together like we usually are, and that made me a little bit sad because I don't get to see all your wonderful smiley faces. But then I realized one of the things we can do in this new format we have for services that I couldn't do if we were in church together is that I can take you one of my favorite places, which is my tent. I slept in it for many nights while I was on the AT, and I'd love to take you there and read the story from inside my tent. So let's go. Let's go inside together and read the book. Tomorrow I'll Be Brave by Jessica Hish. Tomorrow I'll be adventurous. I'll play and I'll explore. I'll make or learn or try something I've never done before. Tomorrow I'll be strong. I'll climb and jump and run. It doesn't matter if I win, as long as I have fun. Tomorrow I'll be smart. I'll think before I act. I'll solve a puzzle, read a book, and learn a fun new fact. Tomorrow I'll be curious. Please teach me something new. I'll ask why a million times, maybe a million too. Tomorrow I'll be creative. I'll color and I'll draw for hours. I'll play a game of make-believe and use my magic powers. Tomorrow I'll be confident. I'll be proud of all I know. I'll stop and smile and think about how much you've helped me grow. Tomorrow, I'll be brave. There's nothing I can't do. I won't be scared, but if I am, I know that I have you. Tomorrow, I'll be all the things I tried to be today. Adventurous, strong, smart, curious, creative, confident, and brave. And if I wasn't one of them, I know that it's okay, but tonight I'm very sleepy, so now it's time to rest. Tomorrow I'll be all these things, or at least I'll try my best. Thanks for joining me in my tent.
The sounding of the tincture calls us into a time of reflection, calls us into a time for meditation. It encourages us to go to the center of our heart. It stirs something in us, some awareness that some would call soul. Within your heart, within your soul, you may be carrying some joy, some happiness, something that has happened, or you've done, or something you have experienced that lifted your spirit, maybe invited your spirit to soar. Take a moment to be aware of those joys, those causes of happiness. Take a moment to be fully aware of those thoughts and those feelings. Be as aware as you can muster. Take a moment to embrace them, to hold them close. Hold them close. And now, release your embrace. Within your heart, within your soul, you may be carrying pain, perhaps worry or sorrow, even anguish or despair. You may have received some bad news, experienced some loss, or you're anticipating some loss. You may be grieving that loss. Take a moment to be aware of those pains, those causes of sadness, anguish, grief, or despair. Take a moment to be fully aware of those thoughts and those feelings, as fully aware as you can muster. Take a moment to embrace them, to hold them close, hold them firm. And now, release your embrace. As you allowed yourself to embrace your feelings, particularly your pain, your sadness, your grief, you were being brave. You were allowing yourself to be conscious, however briefly, of what you were feeling, and however briefly, allowing yourself to experience the vulnerability of contemplating, perhaps even facing, the consequences that would come with those feelings. Have courage, my friends, and let us carry on. Let us carry on singly and together in facing our vulnerability, in facing the consequences of what is happening inside of us. Let us carry on. Let us be carried by the spirit of life, which connects us to ourselves, to each other, and to all of humanity. Let us hold ourselves and each other in the embrace of the moment of silence. And now, our morning reading. which comes from David White, from his book Consolations, the Solace, Nourishment, and Underlining Meaning of Everyday Words. The specific reading is titled On Courage. Courage is a word that tempts us to think outwardly, to run bravely against opposing fire, to do something under besieging circumstances, and perhaps above all, to be seen to do it in public, to show courage, to be celebrated in story, rewarded with medals, given the accolade. But a look at its linguistic origins is to look in a more interior direction and towards its original template, the old Norman French courage, or heart. Courage is the measure of our heartfelt participation with life, with another, with a community, a work, a future. To be courageous is not necessarily to go anywhere or to do anything except to make conscious those things we already feel deeply, and then to live through the unending vulnerabilities of those conscious. To be courageous is to seat our feelings deeply in the body and in the world, to live up to and into the necessities of relationships that often already exist with things we already care deeply about, with a person, a future, a possibility in society, or with an unknown that begs us on and always has begged us on. To be courageous is to stay close to the way we were made.
Thank you.
There are a few times in the service when I'm going to reference some disturbing events. You may want to preview or have someone preview for you this portion of the service prior to viewing it. On May 3rd, 1955, 67-year-old Emma Rowena Gatewood laced up her KED sneakers, slung her handmade denim bag over her shoulder, and stepped onto the Appalachian Trail. According to Ben Montgomery in his wonderful book, Grandma Gatewood's Walk, she had informed her 11 grown children that she was going for a walk. She did not feel a need to provide any further details. Emma left Ohio behind her and found herself on the threshold of realizing a dream she'd been mulling over since she saw an article about the trail in a 1949 issue of National Geographic. The Appalachian Trail, simply known as the AT, was first conceived of in 1921 by Brendan McKay, a forester, planner, and conservationist who grew up and went to school right here in New England. McKay's vision of an interconnected trail that traversed the spine of the Appalachian Mountains through 14 states from Georgia to Maine was not completed until 1937. And on that May morning, 18 years later, when Emma exited the taxicab on a dirt road in the mountains of Georgia, few people in the country were even aware that the trail existed. When Emma started her journey, the community network of trail angels, hostels, and shelters that I relied on during my hike did not exist. In fact, many that lived along the trail in those days were suspicious of the people that wandered out of the woods. Early hikers certainly didn't carry cell phones loaded with map apps that told you where the closest water source were, or gave you a list of phone numbers of shuttle drivers willing to take you into town for a resupply. No. According to Montgomery, Emma Gatewood's handmade denim bag contained minimal food, a few first aid supplies, one change of clothes, a warm coat, a shower curtain, Swiss Army knife, flashlight, candy mints, a pen, and a small notebook. That was it. Emma did not have a fancy Gore-Tex raincoat with zip-open pit ventilation, nor did she have any polar fleece or smart wool clothes. No fancy, seasoned, dehydrated foods. She did not even have a tent or hiking shoes. And yet, she did it. She walked the entire length of the AT all the way to Maine. Emma Gatewood holds the distinction of being the first woman to thru-hike the AT solo. The Appalachian Trail Conservancy defines a thru-hike as a hike of the entire Appalachian Trail in 12 months or less. The trail's first thru-hiker was Paul Schaefer, who completed the trail in 1948 at the age of 29. The first woman to ever thru-hike the AT was Mildred Norman Ryder. Many of you may know her as the Peace Pilgrim. She hiked with a companion in 1952. But the honor of being the first female solo thru-hiker of the Appalachian Trail goes to Emma Rowena Gatewood. She also holds the distinction of being the first person, male or female, to thru-hike the AT a second time, when she did it again at the age of 72. And for good measure, she hiked the trail again in 1963, at the young age of 75. Was Emma Gatewood scared? Apparently, she was afraid of bears. But Emma Gatewood lived with a tyrant of a husband who beat and abused her regularly. So it is not surprising that the fear of a bear attack would not dissuade Emma from the peace and solitude that the meandering trail through the mountains and forests promised. I can easily recognize, without a doubt, that Grandma Gatewood was one courageous lady. What I could not recognize prior to my trip and continue to wrestle with now that I am home is the thought that I too was courageous. Am courageous? Can be courageous? I certainly do not feel brave in the way that others appear to see me. And yet here I am speaking to you about courage. I had a real crisis of confidence a few weeks back. It had been a long time ago in January when I first thought that offering a service such as this would be a good idea. Doesn't January seem like a lifetime ago? A few weeks back, in the week of John Lewis's death, courage personified, as healthcare workers and grocery store clerks continued to take on certain risk in the service of others, in the time of an oh-so-necessary rise in volume around issues of racial injustice amplified by yet another senseless and infuriating death, I found myself contemplating my commitment to this service. Really, in the face of all the exemplary models of empowering inspiration that abound in these crazy times, I am going to talk about the courage it took to walk in the woods. I am because I know the following to be true. Courage is an individualized characteristic. The things that scare others don't necessarily scare us, and the thing that scares us don't always scare others. Last month, Madeline Swiegel became the U.S. Navy's first Black female fighter pilot. Maybe she's afraid of the woods and its bears and snakes, but it's pretty clear that she isn't afraid of committing her life to the defense of our country or of flying at speeds that make her head slam back against the seat. But fear is fear, and if you are scared, you are scared. It does not matter that others may not see risk lurking where you are sure it lies in wait. Facing your fears, whatever they are, and deciding to act anyway takes courage. So yes, I'm going to talk about my walk in the woods through the lens of courage. It is my hope that in some way, I will encourage you to face your anxieties and go for it, whatever it is. I was in my late 20s and new to hiking when I first noticed that some of the blazes, the slashes of paint on trees and rocks that are used to mark the trail, were blue, others were yellow, and some were white. My more experienced hiking partner said, "The white ones mark the Appalachian Trail." "What's the Appalachian Trail?" I asked. "A continuous footpath from Georgia to Maine," was the answer. "What? You can step on a trail in Georgia and follow those 2-inch by 6-inch strips of white paint over 2,000 miles all the way to Maine?" "Yep." That tantalizing concept sat percolating for 30 plus years. In December of 2017, at the age of 55, I found myself on the cusp of an empty nest, burnt out by my demanding job, and acutely aware that I was months away from a birthday that would have me at the same age my mother was when she was diagnosed with early onset Alzheimer's, a disease that robbed her of her memories and abilities and took her life just 7 short years later. I was in a perfect storm of restlessness. A tiny voice in my head said, you should try the trail. I told no one of this crazy idea. What I did do was start reading. I have at least 3 linear feet of dog-eared books about long-distance hiking on the bookshelves in my home. I pored over books for weeks before I could find it in myself to whisper to my husband and children. I'm thinking I might, maybe, I don't know, go on a really long walk in the woods. Those many books showed me what was possible, bolstered my confidence, and prepared me for the trail. I don't know what it is that is calling you to take a leap, but I do know that there are many books out there that contain inspiring stories and pragmatic advice on a whole host of topics. Not all who exhibit bravery have the luxury of preparing in advance to answer a courageous call, but many of us do. I encourage you to prepare for the dreams that call you. Read books, magazines, and blogs. Draw inspirations from others. Stand on the shoulders of those giants, you know, those 5'2" grandmas that went before you. Your grandma Gatewood is out there. You can find her, and she can inspire you. I will admit that all the reading in the world may not ease our worried minds. Yes, there are risks in the world. Some are very real and ironically ignored. Others are imagined and often blown into super scary mind monsters. We humans are awful at assessing risk. Daniel Gardner, in his book, The Science of Fear, explains all the varied ways we misestimate risk. If we believe we are in control of the situation, we underestimate risk. And if we feel we don't have control, we overestimate risk. This is why so many fear flying, when in reality, statistically, it is during the drive to the airport when we have that false sense that we are in control that we should be really paying attention. Gardner tells us that if something feels good, like sunbathing, we think, how can something that feels so good be bad for you? And we oil up. If something is novel or we don't understand how it works, like nuclear power, we are certain that the risks are too high to warrant the benefits. I think that it was this fear of the unknown that led people, after hearing of my plans, to blurt out in disbelief, alone? I'm assuming that my loving family and friends were afraid on my behalf of bears, rattlesnakes, the potential for my getting lost, and of ill-intentioned strangers. I had spent enough time in the woods of New Hampshire and done enough research to not harbor those same fears. In fact, I began to flippantly say to anyone who expressed their worry, you didn't call me every day when I was commuting on 128 to see if I got to work okay. Statistically, I had more of a chance of dying on the highways outside of Boston than I do on the AT. No, I assured everyone that the incidence of violence on the Appalachian Trail was so low as to be inconsequential. And yet, in the early morning hours of the Saturday of Mother's Day weekend, 18 to 20 miles north of where my trail family, and I had spent the night, tragedy struck the trail. Ronald Sanchez Jr., known by his trail name Stronghold, was brutally murdered by a man wielding a machete. A very brave woman was seriously injured in the attack. She played dead until the man left and then walked 6 miles along the trail to call for help. Others at the once tranquil spot by the river escaped the type of injuries that bleed, but like the woman that ran for help, will no doubt wrestle with trauma for quite some time. Needless to say, those days on the trail were a whirlwind of emotions. However,
and with full realization that to Ronald Sanchez's family, statistics do not matter, I will continue to put my faith in the numbers. According to an article published by Clay Bonnieman Evans in a popular trail blog called The Trek, there have been 10 murders in 8 different incidents on the AT since the first one occurred back in 1974. I will spare you all the math. It is there, and it is well done. But the fact remains that the U.S. murder rate per capita per year is more than 1,000 times higher than the equivalent rate on the AT. Numbers don't always make it easier to sleep. I read a while back in a place I don't recall that if you have lost faith in humanity, then you should hike the AT. The Appalachian Trail is full of some of the most kind-hearted, warm, caring, and adventuresome people I have ever had the pleasure to have met. It's like a 2,000 mile UU coffee hour. The trail is a trail of peace and love. And so, in spite of the heart-wrenching tragedy that shook the hiking community last year, yes, I will not hesitate to encourage those that I love and those that are willing to go days without a shower to consider hiking the Appalachian Trail. The trail taught me many things. The most powerful of those is that it is possible to learn to trust yourself. After I'd shared my AT story with the wonderful liberal ladies of the Unitarian Universal Church of Reading, a woman in the audience asked me if I had always been this brave and adventurous. It took everything I had to keep my chin from dropping to the floor. The answer is no. I was not always brave. In fact, I was quite the opposite of brave for large portions of my life. But I stand here to tell you that if I can learn to trust myself enough to walk into those woods alone, that I have no doubt that the most timid and fearful among us has within them the courage needed to brace their aspirations. So, what calls you? What dreams have you deferred due to fear, anxiety, or perceived risks? We humans often have a battle of the many minds. We have a voice that dreams big and imagines a future of great possibility. Unfortunately, she has a roommate in that gray matter space that is quick to douse the flames of potential and replace it with a flood of fear. I urge you to turn up the volume of the voice of possibility. Do the work needed to dull the risk-illiterate voice of catastrophe. The French-Cuban-American writer Anaïs Nin rightly tells us that life shrinks or expands in proportion to one's courage. Expand your life, my friends. Be brave.
Taking up an offering is a spiritual practice, just as is prayer or other acts of consecration. Our spirit of giving is deepened by the sharing of our plate with organizations that give to those who are in need of our support. Bread and Roses will continue all this summer as our Share the Plate recipient. Bread and Roses is working to address the devastating impact of the coronavirus and the impact that it's had on Lawrence, which means during this time that Bread and Roses is dealing with an unprecedented demand. Now, Bread and Roses is a soup kitchen in the center of Lawrence, Mass., a city known as the Immigrant City. It was founded 40 years ago, and their primary purpose is to ease hunger in the community. UUCR has been supporting Bread and Roses since 2012 by providing the meal on the first Saturday of every month. UUCR members buy the ingredients, and the meal is prepared in UUCR's kitchen by a team of volunteers from our church. Several congregation members go to Lawrence to help sort donations 3 or 4 times a month. And once a year, our youth bake cookies for Bread and Roses. So our congregation has a deep connection with Bread and Roses. Now, due to COVID-19, there is no longer a way to safely serve communal meals. So Bread and Roses utilizes its 2 outreach vans to deliver bulk food and meals to churches and agencies serving the most vulnerable in Lawrence. The need is greater than ever, so please give generously to our Sunday Share the Plate offering to support both the mission of UUCR and the mission of Bread and Roses. And here's how you can contribute to Share the Plate. You can go online and use your bank online bill pay feature. If possible, write Share the Plate in the memo field or the account number field. Or you can go to uureading.org/connection/donate and select weekly offering /Share the Plate fund. You can pay by check, and please again write Share the Plate in the memo field, and then mail your check to the church, the address being Unitarian Universalist Church of Reading, 239 Woburn Street, Reading, Mass., 01867. Again, you can get that address from our website. The Share the Plate morning offering, we know will be generously given, and you know it will be gratefully received.
You can be amazing, you can turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be an outcast or be the backlash of somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way that words do when they settle neath your skin. Kept on the inside, no sunlight, sometimes a shadow wins. But I wonder what would happen if you say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, you'll be brave with what you want to say and let the words fall out. Honestly, you'll be brave. Stared down by the enemy, fallen for the fear and done some disappearing. Bow down to the mighty. Don't run, just stop holding your tongue.
as I would extinguish our chalice and those of you at home extinguish yours, let us join together saying our chalice extinguishing words. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts.
Today's closing words come from the book Embers by Richard Wagamese. You can't test your courage timidly. You have to run through the fire, arms waving, legs pumping, and heart beating wildly with the effort of reclaiming something vital, lost, laid aside, or just plain forgotten. When you do that, you discover that we shine most brightly in community. The whole bedraggled, worn, frayed, and tattered lot of us, bound together forever by a shared courage, a family forged in the heat of earnest struggle. I hold your hands symbolically now. Wish I could hold them in person. May you draw inspiration from those who have trod before you on the challenging trails of life. Love from those who encourage you to stretch and grow, and courage from the power and wisdom found inside each and every one of us. Thank you for sharing your morning with us.